Today, let's talk about happiness. What is happiness, and why are we humans so engrossed by the idea of happiness? Is happiness something that we need as a species, or is it just a byproduct of our evolutionary activities? Can happiness be observed and measured? Today, let's look at happiness from a scientific lens. Let's start with the basic everyday meaning of happiness. Before making this video, I asked a few people this simple question. What is happiness to you? I got about 30 replies. Here's a summary of the comments. Basically, all the answers fell into one of two baskets. Number one, happiness that involves only oneself. And number two, happiness that involves others, such as friends, family, and the world at large. Incidentally, Aristotle, in his treatise called Nicomachean Ethics that he wrote circa 340 BC, also categorizes happiness in two big baskets, hedonia, pleasure of the senses, and eudaimonia, pleasure of reason, living well and doing well. My guess is that as humanity gets shaped more and more by the four hedonic forces of democracy, welfare capitalism, individualism, and big data platforms, happiness will become more and more happiness that involves only oneself. Now that we have a working understanding of happiness, let's look at the biology of happiness. Traditionally, happiness has been a branch of philosophy and psychology. But in 1872, Charles Darwin put biology's foot in the door of the study of happiness with his third book, The Expression of the Emotions in Man and Animals. In this book, Darwin postulated that emotions must be the key to the survival of the fittest. But not many paid attention to this idea of Darwin. No wonder this book is called Darwin's forgotten masterpiece. But then, in 1953, two scientists, Olds and Milner, and a fearless rat, made a startling discovery by accident. Olds and Milner had implanted an electrode into the area of rats' brain that was found to have created a fear response in rats. The idea was to send mild electrical shocks to this fear response area through this electrode. Now, lab rats hated this exercise so much that they would avoid anything associated with the moment of brain stimulation. But this rat was different. It did the opposite. It kept returning to the corner of the cage where it had been shocked, as if it was hoping for more shocks. The two scientists quickly found out that this indeed was the case. The rat did love these shocks. So it was actually Olds and Milner who were shocked by this strange behavior of the rat. What actually had happened was that Olds had implanted the electrode in the wrong area. By mistake, he had found an area of the brain that the two scientists termed the pleasure center of the brain. Olds and Milner assumed that they had found a way of artificially manipulating the rat's brain to make it feel pleasure and happiness. But soon, neuroscientists found that rat was not experiencing pleasure or happiness. In fact, it was experiencing desire. Today, scientific understanding of happiness or pleasure versus desire has gotten much deeper than it was back in 1953. Olds and Milner had found reward center of the brain, not the pleasure center of the brain. Basically, when you feel a desire, your brain releases a chemical called dopamine. Dopamine is our expectation hormone. Dopamine release doesn't cause happiness. It causes desire or expectation of happiness. Dopamine tells us to focus on the things that might give us happiness. Organic evolution doesn't care at all for your happiness. Evolution only cares about making sure that your genes are passed to the next generation in the most effective way. And for that, evolution has given us dopamine. Much like a greedy but clever politician, dopamine keeps us busy with the promise of happiness, but it never gives us the direct experience of happiness itself.
Now, don't get me wrong here. Dopamine is important for us.
Dopamine motivates us to seek food, shelter, companionship, and other things we need to chase to improve the chance of survival.
Dopamine motivates us to want more and more and even more of things that feel good.
Without dopamine, you won't have the desire to eat, even if you're literally starving.
So, dopamine is important for us so that we can desire things important for our survival.
The promise of reward is so important for evolution that nature doesn't put a cap on how much of it can be released in our bodies. In other words, dopamine keeps us seeking the promise of happiness, even if it ends up making us unhappy in the process.
Whenever dopamine is released in our brain's reward center, it also brings along its cronies, stress hormones. Why? Well, dopamine creates expectation of happiness. The stress hormones create the stress of not having that happiness yet.
So the combination of dopamine and stress hormones prompts us to take action that increases our chances of survival and procreation.
So that was dopamine, the driver of desire, not happiness.
So, if dopamine is not the primary driver of happiness, then what is?
Enter serotonin. While dopamine motivates you to chase desires that must be fulfilled now, serotonin makes you feel happiness that lasts a long time. Dopamine tells you to take things from the world. Serotonin tells you to give things to the world. Dopamine makes you prioritize yourself, but serotonin makes you prioritize the society, the group that you are part of.
Now that we have a basic understanding of the difference between expectation of happiness and happiness itself, let's see what's making us less happier by the day.
Now we know that our brain deceives us into believing that expectation or desire of happiness will result in happiness. On top of that, there are at least three thinking patterns that keep us unhappy. First and foremost, most people are unhappy because they misunderstand unhappiness. We think we become unhappy when we do not get what we wanted. But more often than not, we become unhappy when we do not want what we like. Think about it for a second. Unhappiness is when you put effort into doing something, get it in your possession, and then realize that it's not making you as happy as you thought. Why? Simply because you're pursuing the wrong thing to begin with. For example, money. How much money would make you happy? According to classical economics, the more money a person has, the happier they should be. But is it true? Well, research suggests that's not the case. A study in 2010 by Princeton University's Daniel Kahneman and Angus Deighton revealed that after $75,000 a year, your happiness plateaus. Or take shopping. Shopaholics buy lots of stuff. But does buying a lot of stuff make them more happy? Not at all. In fact, it creates more problems in terms of storing and upkeep of their ever-increasing inventory of possessions. The unholy mix of dopamine and stress hormone cortisol makes life very difficult and unhappy for shopaholics. The second biggest reason is the fact that we compare all aspects of our life to that of others in our vicinity. We are constantly comparing with others our house, car, bank balance, the school that our kids attend, golf handicaps. In this world of non-stop comparisons, nobody can be truly happy. The third biggest reason we are chronically unhappy is called hedonic adaptation. In simple words, we get used to our possessions. Imagine what happens when you buy your dream smartphone. For the first week or so, every time you use it, you marvel at how amazing it is. But after 3 months, you get used to it. Your dream phone no longer excites you even a single bit. So these three reasons, not wanting what you like, incessant comparison, and hedonic adaptation, keep us unhappy. Now, let's see how we can become truly happy.
So, what's the key to true happiness? Technically speaking, simply do more of the things that create a lot of serotonin in your body and do less of the things that create a lot of dopamine. Which actions and behaviors are serotonin friendly and which ones are dopamine plus cortisol friendly? I have a simple way of finding out. Ask yourself, this thing that I do in order to feel better, is it easy to start and difficult to stop? Or is it the other way around? Difficult to start, but easy to stop. Activities that are easy to start but difficult to stop are dopamine plus cortisol friendly. And this combination of dopamine and cortisol is what makes these activities addictive. For example, sugar addiction, video game addiction, junk food addiction, social media addiction, etc. On the other hand, activities that are comparatively difficult to start but easy to stop are serotonin friendly. For example, brisk walking, running, eating healthy food, learning a new language, etc. So do more of these serotonin friendly activities and less of dopamine plus cortisol friendly activities. Next, stop incessant comparison. Studies have shown that incessant comparison is closely linked to low self-esteem, loss of individuality, and poor mental health. So how to stop comparing yourself with others continuously 24/7? The biggest comparison trigger is social media apps. Open any social media app and you will see your colleagues and relatives and friends having such a happy time, eating, drinking, holidaying, and whatnot. Stop or limit the use of social media apps to say 15 to 20 minutes every day. Initially, when you force yourself to stop doom scrolling, it will make you feel bad. The quickest way to change this bad emotional state to a good emotional state is very simple. Move your body. As soon as your 20-minute doom scrolling time is over, stand up and walk 1 block or 1 kilometer or 1 mile. The distance doesn't matter. Slow or fast doesn't matter. Research shows movement triggers serotonin pathways in your brain. What else can you do with the spare time you have thanks to limiting social media apps to 20 minutes max every day? Focus on real relationships with real people in real time. If you are physically away from friends and family, call them at least once a week. You'll be surprised by how good it feels. Almost all of us suffer from what behavioral scientists call under-sociality bias, i.e., we all severely underestimate how good real social connection feels. So, do not let the under-sociability bias stop you from calling real people. Real social connection leads to serotonin-based happiness. There's an extra benefit of you reducing your dopamine-driven social media apps time and increasing your real social connection time. You nudge your personality into being less self-oriented and more other-oriented. There's ample evidence that other-oriented people are much happier than self-oriented people. If you think you're a bit too self-oriented and want to become more other-oriented, you can start with what I call the CVD method. Give more compliments to people around you, volunteer for social causes, and donate money and possessions to help others. Another thing you can do to stop incessant comparison is to keep a thank you journal. In this journal, talk about 3 things that you are thankful for today. Do it every day. Even if nothing specially positive happened during the course of the day, you can simply show your gratitude to, for example, the coffee machine for making such an amazing cup of coffee in the morning, or to your hot shower for making you relaxed after a long day. Do it every day. In as short as 2 weeks, you'll start paying attention to small but good things happening in your day-to-day life. Finally, let's see how we can deal with hedonic adaptation. Hedonic adaptation mainly applies to things. The more things you gather, the more hedonic adaptation your brain has to do. So what's the way out? One way that I myself adhere to is called Danshari, or Japanese minimalism. During COVID lockdown, I stumbled upon 2 amazing books, Goodbye Everything by Fumio Sasaki and The Joy of Tidying Up by Marie Kondo. And ever since, I've been on this journey of Danshari, i.e. decluttering my life. I've given away 20 plus shirts, 5 pairs of trousers, 5 pairs of shoes, 2 smartphones, the list goes on. The ultimate goal is to have possession of only those things that, in the words of Marie Kondo, spark true joy in me every time I see or use them. Try repairing things. When you repair, assemble, or modify things, you add emotional value to them. That way, the endowment effect kicks in and makes your possessions more valuable to you, and in principle, reduces hedonic adaptation. That was our video for today. If you really liked it, then do subscribe. Subscribing is free for you, but it's a great way of supporting the channel. I'll see you in the next one. Bye-bye.